You know what might be even more fun than a great Bible story? Practicing a great Bible story. Do you believe? What do you believe? Or is that not even the right question? Good morning.
Good morning.
Bienvenidos. Welcome to our worship on this 11th Sunday after Pentecost. Such hope and energy, so can we, huh? The nourishing love of God, the bountiful life of Christ, and persistent growth in the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this world in all its need with the life that comes only from you, through Jesus Christ, our rescuer and ruler. Amen. Good morning. Welcome. Glad you guys are here. So this morning, I'm going to try something a little bit different with you all, and I'm going to invite everybody else to join in too, even from home. So first of all, just kind of get comfortable. Get comfortable. If you want to lie down and rest your eyes for this, you can do that. Otherwise, just sit, get good and comfortable. And I want you to practice listening closely. And I know you guys are good at that because I've seen you do it before. And what I'm going to ask is that as you listen, you keep your mind and your heart open to see if God has something to kind of put in your ear, put in your heart, give you a word, a thought, a feeling. So you can close your eyes if you want, just rest. And I'm going to read something that Mrs. Bone is going to read more of it later. I'm going to read just a little bit now. And I'm going to read it, it's very short, I'm going to read it three times and give us a chance to kind of listen in with our hearts and our minds and our spirits. Samuel was lying down. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am, speak, for I am listening." Then God said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something that will make both ears of anyone who hears it tingle." All right. Well, that story that Mrs. Bone is going to read to us is basically about an old guy who's sort of like a pastor, who is helping a young person learn how to listen for God when God has something to say to that young person. So being an old guy pastor, I was just practicing that with you and with everybody. That's something, it's something you can try at home. Take just a little piece of a Bible story, kind of get comfortable and open your mind and your heart and read it three times slowly and make time to just listen with your mind and your heart and your spirit to see if God might have something to say to you or something to put on your heart. So today we're not just listening to Bible story, you're in it. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning, and thank you, old pastor, old wise pastor, for that beautiful, gentle introduction to Lectio Divina. Gorgeous. Today's first reading is from the book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel," and he said, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called for me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called for me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called for me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Today's epistle is from the letter to the Ephesians. There's several debatable things about this letter, but one thing that is not debatable, that is certain, is that the message is very important and is important to us today as it was then. It comes in two sections. The first is a call for unity for all believers. And in this day and time when we have so many divisions, the call to unity as one in the body of Christ is one that we should be listening to. The second is that each person, each individual has worth and is needed in the body. And in our modern time where we say, "Who am I? Is my life valid? What am I to be doing in this life?" Well, you are a beloved child of God. You have been called as a believer into the body of Christ. And in the body of Christ, you've been given gifts that are needed by the body of Christ. So it's as important to us now as it was earlier. A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. "I, therefore, a prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. For the word in Scripture, for the word among us, for the word within us, thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O God. And this follows what we had last week with Jesus feeding the 5,000, and then the crowds followed after him. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to you, O Christ. In the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Here we believe?
Do you believe? But what do you believe? Do you believe that the Spirit was sent by the Father, or that the Spirit was sent by the Father and the Son? Believe it or not, that distinction split the church once upon a time, a little over 1,000 years ago. Some said only by the Father, others said by both. Do you believe that when we celebrate Holy Communion later this morning, that the bread will become the body of Christ through transubstantiation or through something else? Again, not the only thing, but part of what split the Western Church once upon a time. Do you believe that the Scriptures are inerrant or inspired by God? That splits even Lutherans today. What do you believe? To say you believe is lovely, but what is it that you believe? It's actually the wrong question, to be fair. Because the original sense of that word believe, not just in Greek, but even into the English language early on, was not something, one did not believe in a proposition, in an idea. Believing wasn't about thinking the right thing, about being able to quote the right prayer or give affirmation to the right creed. Instead, believing wasn't in something. Believing was in someone. Believing was about relationship. It was about, at its heart, it's a synonym of not thinking but trusting. To believe in you is to not just think you're going to do great at this next year in school, but it is to trust you, to have a deep and abiding relationship with you. One believes in someone. And that's what Jesus is saying in this story that we hear today. And it's what Eli is trying to help Samuel to learn to do with God, is to have a relationship with God, to trust in God, to believe in the one who doesn't sit up on high, just kind of watching us like ants down below, I wonder what's going to happen, but comes to be among us in order to guide us and to show us what God's heart is. And it's not just about, the people ask Jesus, well, what are we supposed to do? What's the work that we're supposed to do? And part of the answer might be to take that word believe, and if you take out the center E, you change from believe to believe, to be living in the one that God has sent to us, to be living in the heart of God, to be living in the intentions of God. That this isn't just something that we think about, that we come on a Sunday morning and we say the right words, but that we go out and we live asking God to speak to us every day, not just when we're asleep in church, like Samuel, but to be asking all the time, I'm listening, Lord. I'm listening. What would you have me do? What would you have me say? To be living in the way that God calls us to live in and through Jesus in particular. And when we do that, when we believe in and through Jesus, it's a very particular way of believing. Because we see what he does. He comes not, as God, the writer of Ephesians tells us, not to divide us into camps. Oh, we've got the folks who sit over in that section, and we get the folks who sit in this section, and then we get the folks who sit in this section, and then we got somebody who's sitting over here, and then that guy who sits back there, you know, which is the holy section. You know, we've got the people who define themselves with this term or with that term, and we do things this way, or we talk that way, but instead, Jesus comes to live with us and among us to remind us that we are all one. We are every single one of us beloved by God. Every single one of us are dear to God. That we are one people. Jesus comes not to make only one particular people special, but to remind one particular people that their job is to bless all people. That gift that was given way back to Abraham and Sarah. I bless you in order that all the world may be blessed. So if you're going to be distinct, that's fine. Be distinct in believing in the love of God, which then turns us as well to one more clarification with this. As we look at how Jesus lives among us, it is one who comes among us with grace that we do not deserve, with patience that is beyond understanding, considering the disciples that he used to have way back then, and the disciples that he still has today. The patience that he has with us, the grace, the forgiveness, the high opinion he has of us. When we think that we don't live up to expectations, that's true, we don't. But he knows that we can, even in our failures, be a gift to the world. You are more than what you have become. You are a gift to the world, because not because of anything that you've done, but because of what God does in and through you, what God has made you to be, what God calls you to be, what God empowers you to be. And we see that in the particular way that God wants us to be in the world for the sake of the world, is the one who came into the world in order to love and save the whole world, which is a very particular love, a love that is beyond just an exchange. Well, if you're nice to me, I'll be nice to you. No, if you're a jerk to me, I will love you, says God. I will call you. I will continue to draw you back, not force you back, but woo you back with a love that is beyond what you can imagine. A love that literally goes to the cross and to the grave and up into resurrection on behalf of all creation. God so loves the world that God does this in and through Jesus. And so we see that if you take believe and change that I to an O, you get beloved. That is how God is in the world, especially through Jesus, and how God yearns to be in the world for the sake of the world through you and me as well. So to believe is to believe, is to beloved. Amen.
Who do you want to be?
Who do I want to be? What other than Dave Tomlinson?
Yeah, you said the person I want to be. What do you mean that you want to be?
I think that I want to be a person who essentially has integrity, who is true to the deepest convictions and values that I hold inside. And I'm not always that. I don't always live consistently with the things that I most, you know. And it's interesting, when I pronounce words of forgiveness or absolution in church on Sunday, you know, and people are often questioned when their visitors question me for doing this, but I introduce it by saying something to the effect of, friends, for all the ways in which we've failed to be the people we most long to be deep down, God forgives us. Forgive yourself. Forgive others. And I think that, you know, people ask me that and say, well, shouldn't you really be saying, for all the ways in which you have disobeyed God? Well, actually, I think I'm saying the same thing. This is how I think of it, because I think that God has implanted within humanity, again, the man who, the atheist I was talking to at the Interfaith Forum this week, you know, he said, do you think that people can be good people without God? I said, absolutely, absolutely. Actually, from a Christian doctrine point of view, that is more about creation, actually, that God has, you know, from a Christian point of view, created us in God's image, and therefore there is that of God.
You called it crappy.
Well, there's that as well. You know, I've always quite liked the Quakers, you know, and the Quakers have this well-worn little mantra of, you know, there is that of God in everyone, and I think that's true, and I think that you know, George Fox, the founder of the Quakers, you know, he talked about the light of Christ within, you know, the light which, as John says in the prologue, enlightens everyone coming into the world. And so Fox, rather than pointing people to God over there, out there, somewhere else, pointed them to the God within. And I think people have what the Quakers call an inner witness, or to put it in other terms, a compass, you know, which I think is what spiritual intelligence is about, sort of developing our capacity to recognize and follow that inner compass, that true north, which as a Christian, I think is, as I say, that of God within. Other people may use different language, but I think we're talking about the same thing. So what I want to be is a person who is true to my deepest sort of beliefs and convictions, which are not absolute in themselves. I think they change over time, you know, but I think, so I look back to earlier times in my life where I believe things slightly differently, but I think that what mattered, or what I feel pleased about or disappointed about, is whether or not I was true to what I believed at that time, you know. I think also what I want to be is someone who is driven and motivated by love. And again, I that's not always true of me. I don't always do the most loving thing, but that's what I aspire to. That's what I long to be. I think that, you know, the three things which I want to identify in the book I'm writing at the moment, you know, if you liked, as a little kind of mission statement for the bad Christian, really, it would be to live passionately, which is what I'm talking about, which is living out of your conviction, living out of a sense of integrity, to live passionately, to love extravagantly, you know, or unconditionally, to always follow the path of love, whatever that might mean. And thirdly, to believe skeptically, which is that tension of being driven by a belief, by something that I'm convinced about, but all the time having doubt as part of the mix of that, because my knowledge is always going to be partial and flawed, and so I have to constantly rethink and refocus. I have to keep on bringing back and looking at the compass again. And so these three things, I think, living passionately, loving extravagantly, and believing skeptically, would be my little mission statement, really.
And the three practices, you say, that will nurture the ability to become a bad Christian?
Well, what you have to understand, you see, Travis, is the bad is the new good.
Peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
Peace, Diane and Colleen and Renee and Nancy. Happy birthday, Renee. Peace to all who are worshiping with us.
Rooted in God the Creator, nourished by the grace of Christ, and produced through the Spirit abundant fruits of compassion for the sake of the world. Amen. And go in peace, believing, be living, and be loving. and serve the Lord. By the presence and power of God, we will.
Thanks for being with us today. Have a blessed week.